what we need to handle. So in this experiment 8, we will try to emphasize much on the exceptions and the basic iterations, how this loop functions are going to work, etc. So to move this exercise, what we are going to do is we will use a table. We will use a table. The name of a table, we are going to call it as some item here. The name of a table we call here as an item here. So we get this item number, and then the item number, it is defined as primary key. Then we are going to have item name and price. Okay, very simple table. And at every point of time, we are mentioning that there's some data must be there. And it should not be empty. Therefore, we are going to use this as not null. Therefore, we are going to use this item as not null. So we created this table, thereby we will make four insert operations. Now, let us see this exception word. So in order to take up this exception word, first of all, we will use the PLSQL block. What is PLSQL block? It is going to have declaration, it is going to have begin, and it is going to have end. So we have declaration, we have begin, and thereby we are going to have end. Okay. Now, what we have done in Java earlier, in Java, in order to represent the exceptions, so we have an exception block. In this exception block, we used to write the exception in the try block. And then we will catch it. If any exception is going to happen, then it goes to throw block, right? So why we are doing all this? We need normal flow of execution. And it cannot be abnormal termination. There is no infinity loop, low hanging of a system. So you don't need all these. It should be programmed. It should be with the program what you have done. From there only, everything has to be taken up. So that is the reason why we are encouraging the exceptions. So in Java, we have try block, we have throw block, and we have catch block. In the same way, and similarly in Java too, we have user-defined exceptions and predefined exceptions. The same model, we have to do the things in PLSQL. That too, we have to implement the same concepts. But there is no try, there is no catch. But appropriate type of reserved words are available. So that is the case. So now we are going to take up local variables name and local variables cost. So name variable must have the same data type and the same size of iName which is in item table. So that is the reason why we are mentioning percentage type. The percentage type, why we are mentioning? Because
Whatever item name is going to have the data type, the size, etc., the same thing has to be cascaded to the name. Similarly, whatever price we had made, if it is not null, etc., the same things has to be cascaded to the cost also. So that is the reason why we are looking in this model. Now, now we are calling the SQL part here. So in SQL part, we are taking select the iName and price into name. So in general, in C, we have I is equals to 0. What does it mean? It means that from the right hand side to the left hand side. But in PLSQL, you can see here, iName is moved to iName is moved to. So you can see here, iName, it is going to be moved to name, and price is moved to cost. So what does this mean? In this mean that if I'm going to have the assignment, the directions will be from left to right. So that was the key takeaway what we need to understand here. In C or in C++ or in Java, everything is right assignment to the left assignment, but in SQL, it is an opposite way, that it is from left to right. So that key takeaway we should understand at this point of time. So selecting some iName and price into name and cost and from the table name, and we should meet up some conditions. It should meet up some condition, that is I number should be 100. Whoever is going to have the I number 1001, for that it is going to take up and thereby displace name and cost. If any abnormalities happen, now we are going to have exception. So exception we are going to call here as a reserved word. Exception, we are going to call it as reserved word. What was it telling? When, then, so you can see here, when followed by then, so exception. So exception, it is common, right? Now you can assume that it is more or less equivalent to try and catch and throw. So you have exceptions, and when exception has to be meted, in this way we are going to bring this. So when no data was found, then it is again no data was, it is reserved, or we can call it as a key word here. So it is going to verify the things. Then you say item is not available. When there is something other it is going to happen, then you should display it as an error. When something other is going to happen, then it should display as a error. So this is how we are checking the exception. So what we will do is we will see that if this is 1001, okay? So you can remember this, 1001 is available, there won't be error. 1, 2, 3, 4 records are there. So if other than this is going to happen, then exception should come. So now what we will do is we will start working on this PLSQL. So that is what we are going to say here. It is experiment, experiment number 8. So it is having loops, and it is having loops, and it is going to have some exceptions. So this is table called as an item, item number, item name, and quantity, etc. So I'm hitting on the run button for towards execution. So it prompts you that the table was created. Thereby, I am doing some 4 insert operations with 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 rows are selected. So let us see. Uh, whether this item is having the table or not, because we are to work with exceptions. So that is why I made this command. So now you can see there are four rows which were selected, and 101 is selected. Now, what was the first exception we are assuming? We are assuming the first exception that it should have a declarative part. Then we are calling up the PLSQL. Then it is a right side alignment, that is from left to right. It is in C, C++, Java, it is from right to left. But in PLSQL now, it is encouraged from left to right. So this is what we start up with exceptions here. So now in this exception, what we were telling that we want to find whether 1001 was there. And if it is there, yeah, you get this item number is not available or available. So it should not lead to some error. Okay, so if it is available, then the item name, that is TV, and the cost, it is 100, that has to be displayed. So now you can see the answer here. Item TV was processed and item cost was taken up. So that is how we taken the first answer here. Now let us see, I will put some error here. Okay, I'll write it as 1008. Okay, 1009. So just check what happens if we are executing this. So because there is 1009, now it should say that the item number is not available, because it is now working from the exception part. So let us try this and check whether the exception is giving us the appropriate answer. Yeah, when we made this, it has 1009, so we got this element. Okay, so that is how we are working with the exceptions. Now let us talk about some user defined exception. In this user defined exception, we simply take as 100, B as 0, and we make a division operation, that is 1 by 0, it is to be infinity. Then it is going to be infinity, some value has to be taken up. So when it is infinity, we understand that the value was infinity. Now the system shouldn't hang. So where it is rising a divide by 0, that is 0 divide error. So what I should get is divide by 0, it should be prompted up. So let us see whether this goes well or not. So now you can see A is assigned with 100, B with 0, and a local variable to compute the division. Then an exception is called, and now let us work with this. So as the value was infinity and the system shouldn't shut down or struck, if not, it should not enter into the infinity loop. So to prevent such abnormal terminations, and to have a normal flow of execution of data, now we are working on this exception. So now you can see that 1 by 100 by 0, it is infinity, and even though it is infinity, still my laptop is not struck. The reason was I have taken this with an exception, and if some divide by 0 has come, definitely it should give me this warning. So in this way, we are increasing the divide by 0 exceptions. So now we have some another example here. So we are now working with the loops etc. So let us see that instead of working directly on loops, you can have an interesting example. That is, we were talking about some CD cost.
we are talking about some CD cost, and CD cost is a variable which it is going to get this item from the item table. So item dot price percentage type. So then what is this? Let us have a discussion. Item is called as the database. Price is going to be called as attribute. Percentage type is as same data type, same size will be given to CD cost variable. So whatever item price dot type is there, the same thing will be given to the CD cost variable. And 100, it is assignment. 100, we call it as an assignment. Okay, fine. Now, if CD cost is greater than 20, then it should raise an exception. There is something happened. Otherwise, if the item cost of CD was less than 20, else what does it mean? Then it should means that if it is less than or equals to 20, then you should update the cost. You should update the cost to the element called as 1003. So for that person, we should update the cost. So first of all, what we will do is we will check the table what we have done. So until what we have done, you will not get a clarity of what I'm talking about. So this was the table available with us. So in this table, what was it telling? CD cost should be greater than 20. Yeah, CD cost should be greater than 20. So now you have this option, right? So the option, what it was talking, it was telling right now the CD price, it is 10 rupees, right? It is only 10 here. So if CD cost is greater than 20, then it should be giving an error. Otherwise, if it is less than or equals to 20, then you do this insert operation with some setting of the price, what it was prompted, right? So what is CD cost assigned? CD cost was assigned as 100. CD cost, it is assigned to 100. So update set car price. Now price will be 100. Now price will be 100. Why it is 100? Because CD cost dot item, we gave this as a 100, and thereby it should display this answer. So to which record it should affect? It should affect only to the record of 1003. It should affect to only the record of 1003. So what we will do is we will now take the declaration part, assign the same data type of price to CD cost, and we initialize the CD cost to 100. Then we are going to call up the main body, that is begin and end, and we check the condition. If it is greater than 20, we make some error. Otherwise, we will update this to the cost what we defined. The cost what we defined was 100. So this is totally put in a if loop. So if followed by condition, followed by then. If it is true, it goes with rise. If it is false, it goes with update. And if it is going to be terminated with an end if. So this is all the total syntax of the if loop. And this if loop, we are now using this to generate it with the exceptions. So CD cost should be less than 20 at line number. So this is some error here. So
Yeah, CD cost should be less than 20. So now you can CD cost is updated. Yeah, exception is called. Now see the item table, how it is looking at it. So just see how the item table will display the result. So what is CD price here? CD price, you can see it is 100. Who updated this? It is updated by exception handling mechanism. So that was the key takeaway of this program. So you can see this one, CD, it was 10, now it is converted to 100. So that was the change you should observe. How did you do this? You have done it with the procedure, and that procedure, it is taken up with the exception handling. It is taken up with an exception handling. So that is all. Now let us have another glimpses of the part two of the eighth experiment, that is how to work with the loops. So this is a classic example, how to print numbers from 1 to 5, and you want to display the numbers from 5 to 1. So how is it possible? So this is an example. So we will use the declaration function. We are initializing the number to 1. Thereby, we are going to use the loop function, and loop will be taken up with the while procedure. So until it is taking up the things, meeting the condition. So when we are going to use up this loops, so while loop, it is an entry check condition. So it is an entry check condition. So we will execute this program to display right from 1 to 5 and 5 to 1. Yeah, now you can see the outputs. So it is displaying 1 to 5 and 5 to 1. So in the storing the output here, there is no quite bit complex logic to explain. So until a condition is satisfied, we met, and again we draw it to 1, and we iterated the loop the number of times the condition has to be met. In that time, we rolled it up. So a simple program. Next another simple program when working with loops, it is that print the 1 to 5 using for loop. Yeah, we already discussed in the previous example, that was how to demonstrate a for loop. So for loop, yeah, again, it is having initialization part. It does has a looping structure. So loop, begin to loop, and it says how many times the for loop has to execute. And then the ending position, the number of times the for loop has to check that condition, it is given as 5 here. So we taught that DBMS underscore output dot put line program started, and how many times this it goes, it is declared in the for loop, and for loop begin and end. So you can see for loop, it executes for 5 times, because you mentioned that for loop has to be called from 1 to 5 times. So that is the reason we got this answer for the for loop. Similarly, what we call it as nesting, if loop, so loop calling another internally. So you say here it is nesting. So how is this nesting happen? You declare a variable bay, you take up the PLSQL procedure, you start the program, you are using a for loop. Inside for loop, now you are going to call the while loop, right? Inside for loop, you are going to call the for loop. So what is this program taking up? This program, it is demonstrating that one loop, it is with the for loop, and the other, and the for loop, it is calling a while loop. So there is some nesting structure, a loop inside another loop is working up. So that's where we say here a nesting loops are coming into picture. So these are very simple examples to a glimpse at the one time you can get these things understood. So we got this word. Yeah. So the loop, it is going to repeat for three times, and until the first is greater than or equals to second. So the loop continues and it gives the answer as 1, 2, 2, 3, 3, 3. So that is how we talked about this experiment 8. In experiment 8, we mostly emphasized on exceptions. That was the primary focus. So exceptions, we talked about predefined exceptions. Then we talked about user-defined exceptions. And after that, we worked on first one we called as a while loop. Then we talked about a for loop. So in this way, we had enough way to look into the different types of loop structures. So this is all from this experiment, that is experiment number 8. Save the script as experiment number 8. So we had 57 statements here. So we will move to the work area here, clear the contents, and yeah.